Hey Sarah, it's me, Dr. Daniel, and this is your functional health report video interpretation. This report was of course generated using the blood chemistry data from your most recent blood draw, which was June 5th of this year, 2020. This report is also attached to the note that you got that contained this video, so just make sure you're on the lookout for that. And I'm also going to be referencing the metabolic assessment form that you filled out for me, which actually helps to really compare the symptoms that you might be having, the subjective symptoms that you might be having, with some of the things that we see from your blood chemistry data. So just keep that in mind, is that I kind of use both of these as clinical tools to see if the information matches. In other words, does the blood chemistry information that we got, the results and the interpretation, match any of the symptoms that you have? And if we see areas that are consistent, well, then those are certainly the areas that we should be attacking or optimizing, working on as a priority. Now, this report again is attached to the note that you got. When you download and open it up, it's hyperlinked. So there's parts of the report that you can click on. It'll take you to different sections and it just makes it easier for you to navigate. For this particular video, I'll be going through the assessment section, the analysis section, and then a potential health improvement plan. If we wanted to base your treatment and recommendations solely on this data, the metabolic health assessment form and the blood chemistry data, there is some information that's going to be listed under practitioner's notes that are not part of my normal typical assessment. We screened you for Epstein-Barr virus. If you click on practitioner's notes, it'll take you here. You'll see the EBV antibody profile, and then these are the results. Now, there are a few markers that help us to determine if you've ever had Epstein-Barr virus in your past and if you have an active infection. The EBV antibody that is IgM, so this IgM is less than 36, which means it's negative. For an active infection. This means you don't currently have Epstein-Barr actively causing problems in your body. However, the titers IgG and the nuclear antibody IgG are positive. These are high. They do suggest a previous infection, but nothing that is active right now. And so we just wanted to make sure that your low energy had nothing to do with that. So just keep that in mind. And then clicking on home takes us back to the table of contents. Now, before I dive into your blood chemistry, I do want to go over the metabolic assessment form that you completed. This is an outcomes form that has been clinically validated that matches or strongly correlates with systems in the body that could be dysfunctional. Certainly with respect to stomach issues, from your blood chemistry, I've identified that you definitely have some digestive inflammation and things that are happening there. I can see why you would also have energy issues, energy balance issues, and that's largely due to glucose issues that are showing up from your blood chemistry. And then again, we can of course see some patterns showing up from this particular assessment form. As far as weight loss resistance, nothing that I pick up actually that would be hormonally, that would be pathological. But if some of these other systems are not functioning well, then it certainly could be contributing to the symptom. And then I do pick up on a few things that would be impacting your mood and overall energy. Starting off with category one, this first category has a lot of symptoms that would be associated with the colon itself. And our colon is really responsible for the microbiome. So this is basically an assessment of your microbiome. When you see the pattern of a lot of things lighting up over here on the right-hand side, that would be an indication of what you would call dysbiosis, which is basically imbalances in good bacteria. You are showing up to have quite a bit in the middle, so I wouldn't entirely consider this to be negative. So I would assume that if we did do a comprehensive stool panel, you'd probably find that you have some imbalances in good bacteria. And these bacteria play a major role in our immunity. They play a major role in our ability to digest the food that we're eating. These bacteria also contribute to producing neuroendocrine compounds that help us to feel good. They help to produce serotonin and dopamine, and so it could certainly be impacting mood. Moving on, category two is really reflecting leaky gut or intestinal barrier issues. And you do kind of have some patterns here that show up to have intestinal barrier issues, but this would be something that we would have to test specifically because it, you know, kind of, you can see here, it goes back and forth. So really not a strong indicator of leaky gut. Category three would be chemical tolerance or toxic load, and it does appear that you actually have some chemical intolerances. On your blood chemistry, we would expect to see low vitamin D and elevated cholesterols, which is in fact what we do see. So this is confirming that there is some chemical issues here, and we might want to consider some kind of a mini detoxification protocol to address this. Category four has to do with your stomach itself. You can see that, you know, there's definitely, again, you're kind of in the middle of the road here. With stomach issues, you would expect to see total proteins on your blood chemistry low, globulin to be low, low white blood cells and high neutrophils, and you exactly match this, which does indicate that you could have possible infection. And so again, a comprehensive stool analysis and parasitology study might be something you want to do or undergo to see if you do in fact have infections, and we would identify specifically what's there. That test also screens your microbiome and tells us how well you're digesting proteins and carbs and fats and all that kind of stuff. But certainly you can see here that, you know, this is popping up. And like I said, your blood chemistry does match with this. Looking at category five, this category here, you can see there's quite a bit that's showing up over in the right-hand column. This has to do with acidity problems, which you obviously have indicated that you've got some acid reflux issues, you've got some stomach issues that have shown up. Certainly it appears that you're not fully digesting the foods you're eating. So in this case, we would definitely want to consider some kind of gut repair protocol. Now, if you have infections, the first step is to get rid of those infections. We could certainly proceed without a comprehensive stool panel, and if you want to do that, then I would recommend a series of antimicrobials, antibacterials to start off with, and then we would follow up with repairing. If you want to know specifically what's happening, then we'd have to do a comprehensive stool panel to figure that out. Looking at category six, this has to do with your pancreas. So digestive enzymes, and again, it does appear that you have some digestive enzyme issues. Digestive enzymes help us to digest proteins, carbs, and fats. Category seven is your small intestine. So if you've ever heard of SIBO, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, if I saw a lot of these markers more towards the right, then we would assume that, but this looks pretty good. Category eight is going to basically be biliary system or gallbladder. So again, if we see more things happening over on the right-hand side, then we assume that you have gallbladder issues. Nothing showing up there. Category nine has to do with your liver. Definitely there is some stuff right here in the middle that's showing up. So that has to do with toxic load and detoxification. Now look here at your sugar metabolism. Pretty heavily over on the right-hand side, right? So this would indicate blood sugar imbalances, blood sugar impairment, and with glucose being the primary source of fuel for our brain, if you're feeling low energy, if you're feeling lethargic, if you're having any kind of energetic issues, getting your blood sugar under control would be the first step. And it does appear that you're having some dysregulation here. I know you don't like pricking your finger, but that would certainly be something we'd want to look at. But going off of this, just from what you're telling me and then looking at your blood chemistry, it does make sense to me that you have some blood sugar problems. Category 11 here is what you would consider to be peripheral glucose usage. So it's one thing to not have proper glucose utilization in the body, but then it's a different thing for, you know, to see how your tissues are responding to glucose. And again, most of your answers are kind of in the center here, which do indicate that you have some issues. In terms of objective measurements, we would also want to match this with elevated insulin, triglycerides, and total and LDL cholesterol, which you do match that as well. So again, definitely some matches here, concordant data from what you're telling me from your symptoms and what I see on your blood chemistry that matches with glucose problems. As far as mood, definitely you're showing signs of adrenal issues. You can see that a lot of your symptoms are kind of over here on the right-hand side. So definitely some possibility of stress hormone dysregulation and adrenal dysfunction. And then category 13 here is usually going to be more reflective of you have hyperfunction of adrenals and hypofunction. And you can see that this is showing hyperfunction of adrenals, but you also have positives for hypo. So basically both of these are for adrenal dysfunction and you're showing up to be high. Category 14 is going to be pH imbalance, which you definitely show not only from your blood chemistry, but from what you're telling me symptomatically. And then category 15, this has a lot to do with your thyroid. Not a whole lot, actually, that shows up here. I would expect there to be a lot more positives or more heavily on the right side, but you're showing to be okay here for both of these thyroid. And then the last one here is going to be hormone balance, which you do have some markers that show up in the right, but a lot more that are over here on the left-hand side. So it doesn't look like hormone imbalance would be a major issue based on this assessment. So again, this is really just a form that helps me to see if the objective data from your blood chemistry matches. Now let's go ahead and dive into your blood chemistry. The systems that you see here are known as functional body systems. This is kind of like a bird's eye view of looking at everything in your body, all the biomarkers that we ordered from your blood tests, and we put those individual biomarkers into systems that they represent, and then patterns start to emerge that allow us to determine which systems are dysfunctional based on the individual biomarkers. For instance, you can see here your cardiovascular risk is elevated. The reason why it would be elevated is because your total cholesterol, your good cholesterol, bad cholesterol, and triglycerides are all high. Now, cholesterol by itself is not a good indicator of cardiovascular risk, but it does infer that there could be some issues here. It's important to also understand that elevated cholesterol could be because of inflammation, which you're showing signs of inflammation, and that could be stemming from your digestive system because you also show signs of digestive dysfunction, specifically inflammation in the digestive system. Now, blood chemistry is not a direct measurement of digestive health. That is where the stool panel comes in. And like I said, we could basically treat this without knowing specifics in a conservative fashion, or if you want to test specifically to see what's happening in the GI system, then that would be a comprehensive stool panel. When you see a little square like this, a little green square, you can click on it. It'll take you to a section to learn more about this particular system, the rationale and the biomarkers considered. So just know that this just gives you additional information. Now, cardiovascular risk is 69% dysfunction. Immune function is at 67%. So this is showing that you have some immune dysregulation, and 80% of our immune system lives within the gastrointestinal system. So it does make sense that if you have stomach issues, digestive issues, then your immune system is going to be impacted. And then, of course, GI function is at 52%. Blood sugar dysregulation is at 50%, thyroid functions at 50%. If we click on accessory systems, these are the systems that support the main physiological systems. Your acid-base chemistry is off. Again, your pH imbalance is off. You showed signs of that from your metabolic assessment form. You have nutritional deficiencies that would be consistent with pH imbalance as well. Your lipid panel is going to show up here because lipids are elevated, and then you are showing lots of signs of inflammation. So there's quite a few markers to suggest high levels of inflammation in the body. And this is likely stemming from your digestive system based on everything that I see. As far as nutrient status goes, this is not necessarily nutrients in your body, but how you're doing as far as extracting, digesting, absorbing nutrients from the food you're eating. So basically, you consume proteins, carbs, fats. Your stomach, your large and small intestine have to extract vitamins and minerals and break proteins down into amino acids and break carbohydrates down into simple sugars so that way we can absorb it. This tells us how well that system's working. And you can see here that your vitamin status is pretty high, suggesting that you're not absorbing a lot of the vitamins that you're consuming. Again, probably because of inflammation in the digestive system. Also, it appears that you're having some issues with protein absorption. That could also be because of inflammation in the gut and or an infection. And then it looks like you're not doing a good job digesting carbohydrates. This could be because of digestive enzyme deficiencies. As far as nutrient deficiencies go, there's quite a few. You have vitamin B12 and folate deficiency, vitamin D deficiency, thiamine or vitamin B1, magnesium, iodine, calcium, zinc, selenium, B6, and vitamin C. So quite a few nutrients that you're deficient in that could be contributing to issues. When I see multiple nutrients like this that we're deficient in, it definitely does suggest that if you didn't have symptoms of digestive issues, I would say that, you know, that's something that we have to look into, because obviously your gut is where you digest and absorb nutrients. And so when you see signs of nutrient malabsorption, and your diet's not bad, I've looked at your diet, but when you see signs of this, then certainly it starts to contribute to problems. You start to think that your gut's not allowing you to absorb these nutrients. Clicking on the home screen will take you back to the table of contents. Now we're going to click on blood test results. There were 79 markers ordered for this study. Starting off with blood glucose, your fasting glucose is not bad. 75 to 85 would be ideal. You're on the high end of optimal. Your estimated average glucose is at 93, which is healthy. Your hemoglobin A1C is 4.9, so that's also healthy. Your insulin, however, is elevated, and then there is a liver enzyme ratio. ALT and AST are liver enzymes. When this ratio is really high, it suggests insulin resistance, or your body's not responding to insulin as well. There is another marker that we'll talk about later called lactate dehydrogenase, or LDH. That's also imbalanced, and that is a reflection of glucose regulation. Now, what happens here is obviously you can see that you have markers that are in the optimal range, and then you have some that are high. This is a pattern of glucose fluctuations, where if your glucose was normal, if your estimated average glucose levels are normal, your hemoglobin A1C, which is a 3-month average of glucose regulation, is normal, but your insulin is elevated, that's telling me that you might be going through periods of high and low glucose. Of course, this is just a snapshot, right? When you get your blood drawn, it's just what your body's doing at that moment. What happens is how your body is responding throughout the day. So if you're going through these highs and lows, so these high levels of glucose and then sugar crashes, the average might be normal, but those individual highs and lows could be causing problems for your energetics. So definitely trying to help improve insulin sensitivity and controlling your LDH, glucose output from the liver, would be an important thing to look at, especially with your symptoms and the metabolic analysis survey. Renal stands for kidney, so this is an assessment of your kidney function. Blood urea nitrogen represents amino acid synthesis and absorption. You can see that's optimal. Creatinine is an indication of being under or over-exercised. When it's low, it would indicate under-exercised. So I'd want to know what kind of physical activity you've been doing over the last 3 weeks. If you have not been working out, then let's try to work on getting back into the gym, maybe doing some light walking, light jogging. I know I've talked to you when you come in for your adjustments. I think you do do a good job of staying physically active. But when you have low creatinine, again, it could indicate that you're not working out enough, or it could also indicate that you're not eating enough protein to balance out the physical activity you're doing. And that's another thing that could impact energy, is if we're not consuming enough calories, you know, you're not eating enough during the day, you eat healthy, but you may not be eating enough, then our energy is going to drop, and that could be also contributing to glucose fluctuations. The most important marker for kidney function is eGFR. As long as this is greater than 90, then we're doing good, and you can see you're at 120. Moving on, looking to electrolytes. Electrolytes help us to assess just electrolyte balance in the body, but it also helps us to understand pH balance in the body. If you have really high sodium or really high potassium, it could indicate adrenal dysfunction. Your potassium is on the high end of optimal, but nothing bad. Sodium to potassium ratio is good. Your chloride is borderline above optimal, which could indicate poor absorption because of low stomach acid. So in other words, when chloride is really high, it can indicate low stomach acid. CO2 is a bicarbonate molecule that is neutralizes acidity. So the more acidity you have in the body, the lower CO2 will be. And you can see that your CO2 is pretty dang low. So decreased levels are usually associated with what you would call metabolic acidosis. Metabolic acidosis just means that you have high levels of acidity. This, do not confuse this with, you know, when you consume acidic foods, it's going to cause higher acid in the body. That's not how this works. Your body has all these mechanisms built in order to maintain normal pH. If we don't have the right nutrient status, if you don't have enough of the vitamins and minerals to do that, well, then you're going to start to see some imbalances here. So CO2 really low indicates pH imbalance. The anion gap is a calculation also used to determine acidity, and the higher this goes, the more acidity there is. So again, this just reflects pH imbalance, which is likely due to vitamin deficiencies. Uric acid is also an indication of glucose regulation, inflammation in the body, that's optimal. Leptin is a hormone that I like to measure whenever there's weight loss resistance or weight loss issues. You don't have any problems with that, so it looks like your leptin levels are normal. Looking at proteins, your total protein is low. So this means you're either not eating enough protein or you're not properly digesting the protein you're eating. And again, that could be because of low stomach acid or stomach acid issues. Albumin and globulin are indicators of immune function and digestive inflammation. The lower that your globulin goes and the lower your total protein goes, it's a stronger indicator of intestinal permeability, aka leaky gut. So this is a pattern where we would assume that you have leaky gut. Or some kind of digestive inflammation. Looking at your minerals, your calcium is low or on the low end of optimal. The calcium to albumin ratio is normal. Your magnesium is low, so we certainly need to work on increasing magnesium levels. And then your copper to zinc ratio, they're both on the high end, but they're normal with respect to each other. So the copper to zinc ratio is normal here. Magnesium is a big one. Let me just talk a little bit about that. Magnesium is involved in every single biochemical reaction in the body. It's responsible for DNA synthesis. So basically, if you don't have enough magnesium, obviously you're going to inhibit DNA synthesis, which means you're going to inhibit protein production. You're going to inhibit enzyme production, hormone production, neurotransmitter production, so brain chemistry. So a lot of things can be impacted whenever we're running low on magnesium. So that's an important one to correct. Looking at your liver, alkaline phosphatase is a liver enzyme. It could indicate impaired liver function or sluggish liver whenever it's low. Earlier, I talked about your metabolic analysis form, and you do, based on your symptoms, it does suggest that you have some toxic load issues or chemical intolerance. Our liver, our spleen, and our kidney are the primary detox organs for our body. And so when we're having issues there, you might start to see impairment in the liver. Now, the two most important enzymes are AST and ALT, and these are normal, which is really good. LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, like I said earlier, when that's low, it can indicate reactive hypoglycemia or low blood glucose or energetic problems. And yours is borderline below optimal. Looking at your iron markers, you're definitely showing signs of iron overload. So this is something that we need to pay attention to. Make sure you're not supplementing with any iron. So make sure no vitamins that you take or anything that you supplement has iron. Your serum iron is elevated and your ferritin, which is the storage of iron, is elevated. This, aside from glucose regulation, this could be contributing to fatigue. When you have too much iron in the body, it basically causes oxidation. Oxidation causes tissue damage. It also starts to impact cells or structures within the cells called mitochondria. And these mitochondria are the powerhouses for our cells. They literally create energy. And so low energy could be because of iron, high iron, also tissue damage or failure to recover from workouts could be because of elevated iron. As far as your lipids go, total cholesterol is not bad. I like it to be anywhere between 180 to 220. So you're okay at 205, but considering some of your symptoms, considering inflammation, this is where we get a little concerned whenever I see some elevated cholesterol. Now, I'm not concerned with total cholesterol by itself. I'd be more concerned with the elevated triglycerides and LDL than anything else. I don't believe you have heart disease. You're not at risk for heart disease, although that does show up from this report because these numbers are elevated. I believe these are elevated because of inflammation and something happening within your digestive system. Moving on, looking at your thyroid markers are, some of them are good, some of them are bad. So first of all, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. TSH is the signal between your brain and your thyroid. Your brain sends the signal to your thyroid to produce hormone. So the signal is working. You can see that's optimal. The signal goes to your thyroid gland and produces T4. This is thyroid hormone. If this is normal, then that tells us the thyroid is functioning. You have to then convert T4 into either T3 or reverse T3. Now, it looks like you might have some hyperfunction of your thyroid, meaning you're converting too much of T4 into T3. Now, I wouldn't necessarily consider this a dysfunction, as most people, especially if you're concerned with weight loss, would have low T3. Yours is normal. So with respect to revving your metabolism, everything looks like it's functioning just fine. So I wouldn't be concerned with having a metabolic issue or metabolism issue because of thyroid. What I do see some issues with is your reverse T3. Reverse T3 is low, which could indicate high stress. So again, this goes back to adrenal issues. It could also indicate inflammation, yo-yo dieting. So if you're not doing a good job of eating consistently well, calorie restriction, if you're not eating enough calories, that could also contribute to it. And then of course, alcohol intake or toxic load to the body. Also, you show a little bit of TPO antibodies that are showing up, which could be autoimmunity, but it's nothing bad. I mean, if this was greater than 30, then I start to get concerned. Now, as far as inflammation goes, you are showing some high signs of inflammation. Again, most of this would be matched back to your gut. So just keep that in mind, is that there's two options that I'm going to be recommending for you. One, option one is to proceed conservatively. We start taking things to help with your glucose control. We start taking things to try to help with your gut. And then we reassess your blood chemistry in 30 days. It's basically following, I would recommend a paleo-based diet for 30 days. I would give you specific supplement recommendations to address gut and glucose dysfunctions. We proceed for 30 days, reassess. If there's improvements, great, then we just continue. If there isn't any improvements, then we would retest or we do some additional testing with your gut. That's option A. Option B would be you could proceed with all that, but we go ahead and proceed with gut testing right now to see what exactly is going on within your digestive system. Looking at your vitamins are low. Vitamin D is low. Vitamin D can also be low because of inflammation. Definitely, this could create all sorts of dysfunctions with your immune system. It would contribute to higher levels of inflammation, just having low levels. So we need to work on increasing this. Also, your B12 is really low and your folate is really low. When I see low B12 and folate, on follow-up studies, we're going to want to look at autoimmune issues that could be related to different types of anemias, pernicious anemia, iron deficiency anemia, or just any kind of nutritional anemia. Now, you have high iron levels. That could be, again, because of your inflammation, but when we see low vitamin status, we've just got poor nutrient absorption. Now, I did measure a hormone called gastrin, which is a hormone that stimulates the production of stomach acid. You can see yours are pretty high. When gastrin levels are high, it indicates high levels of hypersecretion of stomach acid, or it could be peptic ulcers. Now, and not to alarm you, but when gastrin levels are greater than 150, it is highly matched with stomach cancers or tumors. Yours is at 99, far away from greater than 150. So I wouldn't ever assume that, at least not at this level. And we would retest anyway within 30 days. So we're going to know, you know, what your gastrin levels are doing. But this is a strong indicator of some kind of infection within your gut, H. pylori infection, which is the most common infection, or ulcers. And certainly ulcers can get, they become worse whenever you're stressed out because stress increases stomach acid even more. So just something to consider there. Looking at your red blood cells, red blood cell production is a little high. That could be because of the high iron that you have. MCV is elevated. This could be because of the nutrient deficiencies that you've got. And the same thing with low RDW. These are just nutritional deficiencies. Looking at your immune system, your total white blood cells are low. Again, suppressed immune function. Neutrophils are elevated, suggesting a bacterial infection. And from everything that we're evaluating here, it's likely coming from your digestive system. So that's why I say that we could conservatively proceed with following a paleo-based diet. That's what I would suggest. And then during this time, we would take some compounds to help improve glucose regulation. We'd also take some things to address the digestive inflammation and a potential infection. Working blindly, certainly there's things that I could suggest that are safe, that are not going to create any disturbance. Worst case scenario, you don't have any infections, but you're taking this stuff and it helps to clean up your gut. This right here would be the health improvement plan that I would suggest for you. You need to be taking certainly nutrients to improve your B complex or B vitamin status, vitamin D as well. So these would be two nutrients that I would definitely recommend that you start working towards correcting. There are a combination of nutrients that I would suggest for the gastric inflammation. One would be a very general antimicrobial, antibacterial, antiparasitic compound. Another one would be compounds meant to soothe the intestinal lining. We would proceed along with some glucose regulation supplements for 30 days, retest, see how you're doing. That would be option A. Option B is to do all that. We take all these things, but we go ahead and test for your digestive system right now. So you let me know which one you want to do. I'm going to put together recommendations initially. The only thing I need to know is whether you want to hold off on gut testing or if you want to do that right now. So just let me know. I'm going to put together the recommendations, and then certainly feel free to schedule some time and we can go over everything.